Chongzhen committed suicide in despair, putting a tragic end to his era. The collapse of the Ming Dynasty did not ensure Li Zicheng control of the situation. Wu Sangui came to the fore during this moment of upheaval. Wu Sangui turned 33 in 1644. He should be the prime of his life. Yet he was under the greatest stress ever in the past 2 years. In the Battle of Songjin, the Ming regime lost the Ming-Qing line it painstakingly built up. Wu-controlled Mingyuan became the last Ming fortress north of the Shanghai Pass. In the same year, Wu was appointed Liaodong General, the top military officer in Mingyuan. Commanding all the Ming troops in Liaodong, Wu reached the zenith of his career, only to find himself atop a melting iceberg. To his west, the situation in his home country was rapidly deteriorating. The towering walls of the Shanghai Pass blocked out the cries of starving refugees and fierce rebels. Wu thus had a transient moment of peace. On the vast plain to his east, the flood of Qing troops threatened to overwhelm Mingyuan. The Ming Empire was crumbling. Even from the faraway Shanghai Pass, Wu Sangui could sense its imminent demise. In January 1644, Li Zicheng inaugurated the Xun Dynasty in Xi'an. Li soon led a northward expedition across the Yellow River towards Beijing. The Ming Dynasty was nearly depleted of its elite troops and officers. Wu Sangui's 30,000-strong cavalry was Emperor Chongzhen's last bid. On March 6th, Wu received Chongzhen's order to withdraw from Mingyuan to reinforce Beijing. But even the conferred title of Lord Ping Shi failed to delight Wu Sangui.
他的所有的家当都是在这个辽东这个土地上，当时呢，就是他们所有的人都是最大的地主，所以呢，这个时候他首先要考虑他的经济利益。第二个呢，就是说他呢有三万的精兵，那么三万兵呢还有七八万的僚民，那么这些呢都是他的属下，那么这些的兵呢，这个七八万的僚民呢就是他的这个将士的家属，他必须要考虑如何安置的问题。
To serve his country on the battlefield was his lifelong dream. His father's decades-long military career had influenced him since childhood. The blood and sweat Wu shed over the years fighting for the Ming Empire was all for the good name as a loyal vassal and a filial son. When Beijing was in danger, only his 30,000 troops could save the Ming Dynasty. But the invincible Xun army with soaring morale made Wu unsure whether his men could turn the tide. Since childhood, Wu had admired his father dressed in full armor. The withdrawal to reinforce Beijing was especially significant. Wu's whole family lived there, including his most respected father, Wu Xiang.
父亲已经就是被在提督经营在京城，他的一家老小也在京城。那么也就是说，他面临着一次前所未有的一次抉择，和以往的撤兵不同，这是要放弃一块土地，所以这些人呢需要跟着他一块走。而且呢，关外的这些百姓听说他们要撤去，也要跟着他一块走，这样呢就不是七八万人的问题了，那么史书上说他有五十万之众。
On March 11, 1644, Wu Sangui set out west for Beijing with his Grand Ming troops. The overlarge procession marched slowly. With civilians bringing along the old and the young, they traveled no more than 25 kilometers a day. On March 20th, they finally reached Fengren in Hebei province, which was still several hundred kilometers from Beijing. Wu never imagined the Shun army had already captured Beijing the previous day. On Meishan Hill, Chongzhen put an end to both himself and the 276-year-old Ming Dynasty. The surprisingly quick fall of Beijing shocked Wu Sangui, who was also unaware of the tragedies in the capital. You could hardly believe the peasant rebels captured Beijing so quickly. Yesterday, he was still chief general and Lord Ping-Chi. Now he was the vassal of a demolished state. Wu Sangui strived for more than a decade to ascend the ranks of the Ming aristocracy. But he finally realized that fate was unavoidable even if he reached the summit. The Ming dynasty that honored him had perished. The emperor that he was loyal to had passed away. His world fell apart. He faced another difficult choice. Each option was equally cruel. The fall of the capital and the emperor's death rendered the push towards Beijing moot. Wu instantly ordered a retreat to Shanghai Pass. It's an unprecedented year in Chinese history. Or flee, do or die. The ruler of a falling empire faced his end. How would a grassroots hero steer the fate of a dynasty? Was the formidable general anger for the sake of a beauty? Was Manchu's triumph accidental? Who steered the course of history? Three power groups fought toe-to-toe for domination. What was behind the transition from the Ming to Qing dynasties? 1644. At a turbulent turning point, Wu Sangui's destiny intersected with history. If history had determined his earlier fortune, then Wu's decision to turn back was an attempt to baffle fate. He had indeed become a decisive force in the war between the Ming and Qing dynasties. As a major Ming border fortress, the Shanhai Pass was called the first pass under heaven. Bordering the sea to the east and mountains to the north, it's a formidable defense. It kept the Qing army at bay, several hundred kilometers away from Beijing. The majestic Shanhai Pass was Wu's only chance for survival. Yet, control of the pass was unable to dispel Wu's uncertainties of his future.
明朝就亡了，他没国了，他的家、父母都在北京，说他有家难投，就让他带着他的这个部队住在山关。
皇帝也没有了，明朝的朝廷也不复存在了。在这个时候，吴三桂的处境可以用四个字来形容：无处收留。他的这支大军转眼间成了无处收留的大军，没有去向了已经。
April 29, 1644. Li Zicheng's envoy arrived at the Shanhai Pass to recruit Wu Sangui. A gift of 40,000 taels of silver was timely help for Wu's troops that had been unpaid for 14 months. The envoy also presented the order to grant Wu a noble title and a support letter from Wu's father. The opportunity has slipped away, and fate is irreversible. Our emperor has already passed away. Your father is to follow suit soon. An early surrender would ensure you a marquis title and praise as a filial son. With the emperor dead, his father became Wu's purpose to keep going. Unable to be a loyal vassal, he could at least be a filial son. For his father, Wu violated his moral principle for the first time. Wu left the Shanghai Pass to the Xun army. On April 4th, he set off for Beijing with his Guanming troops to surrender to Li Zicheng.
这个突然间的转变呢，实事求是的说呢，首先是吴善桂呢归附大顺政权呢，本身呢他就不是出于自己的这样一个诚心，而是作为一种呢暂时观望的一种这个徘徊。吴善桂啊，他们的这种他手下的官宁铁骑也当时在山海关了，打出的呢仍然是明朝的旗号，根本没有一旗。 也没有这个换上李自成部队的大顺军的这样一些印信，都没有，所以他本身投降大顺政权就是非常脆弱的，非常脆弱的一种协议式的投降。吴三桂
was both worried and expectant. After all, he was exchanging the much coveted Shanghai Pass for the safety of his family and his beloved Chen Yuan Yuan.
Chen Yuan是一个江淮名妓，啊，这个人是相貌非凡，才艺绝伦，非常得到吴三桂的宠爱。他当时有考虑，考虑什么呢？一个是李成开的条件很好，还有他父母在北京，他最心爱的女人陈圆圆也在北京，说这几方的因素考虑的话呢，他就当李成给他这样优厚的条件的时候呢，他很快就接受了。
Wu Sangui had imagined a warm welcome upon his arrival in Beijing. He was excited with the honor as a marquis and the joy of reuniting with his family and Chen Yuan Yuan. He indulged in fantasies, unaware of the tragedies in Beijing. At Xi Xia He Post in Pingxi, Hebei, Wu encountered his servant.
你怎么来了？我们吴家被闯贼霸占了。
Wu Sangui couldn't believe Li would present such a greeting.
我父亲还好吗？
吴老将军被他们抓走了。Fate
had again made a mockery of Wu Sangui.
谁被抓了？吴老将军被他们严刑拷打，快要死了。
The enraged Wu Sangui hit upon an issue that would be the last straw. Disillusioned, bewildered by the shame that was inflicted upon him. How disgraceful it was for a man unable to protect his lady. The unexpected news made Wu change his mind. He decided not to surrender. A dramatic turn of events thus took place in 1644.
所以说呢，陈圆圆对他来说，绝对不是说随意能够赠送的一个东西，啊，就是在过去被认为，女子可以随便当礼品赠送。对他来说不仅仅如此，我们还是把他还原成了一个普通的人，啊，一个有七情六欲的人，一个33岁的普通男人。 啊，我们这么来认识他，所以他还是在血气方刚之年，而且呢，每个人都有自己的自尊，有自己的底线。那么吴三桂这时候的底线呢，应该就是陈圆圆。李自成
was clearly insincere in his proposals for recruitment. The title of Marquis and military pay were only lures to uproot Wu Sangui. Surrendering to Li would just lead to an ignoble existence worse than death for the proud Wu.
他们的火车完，带领他们的军队回到西昌海峡。这次，他们的军队被击毁。他们的军队被击毁。
It's an unprecedented year in Chinese history. Fight or flee. Do or die. The rule of a falling empire faced its end.
皇帝之权归他，考略之威归我。
How would a grassroots hero steer the fate of a dynasty? Was the formidable general anger for the sake of a beauty? Was Manchu's triumph accidental? Who steered the course of history? Three power groups fought toe-to-toe for domination. What was behind the transition from the Ming to Qing dynasties? 1644.
李自成，包括他的手下，能够审时度势，做了一些呢，用我们今天的话讲叫统战工作，把这个吴三桂安抚好。那么吴三桂呢，在利益驱使面前呢，我想啊，他可以呢，转化为真正投降，这种协议式投降可以转化为真正投降。然而呢，李自成非常失败。 他手下的大将们呢，对吴三桂的爱妾陈圆圆呢进行了霸占，然后还把这个吴三桂的父亲拘禁了起来。The
Shanghai Pass was surprisingly quiet after the heated battle. The rage had subsided. Facing his father's portrait, Wu found himself completely homeless. Fate had toyed with his beliefs. He could be neither a loyal vassal nor a filial son. He became lost, unable to find a purpose in the world. Wu still controlled the critical Shanghai Pass, but was without a clue what to do with it. He certainly will not give Li Zicheng any more chances. Execution of his envoy marked a complete break with Li. Wu wrote a farewell letter to his father.
Wu 孝男三桂，气血百脉，伤父亲大人心。父亲一生素以忠义自居，如今虽大势已去。 也当拼尽全力，不成，则应以身殉国难。儿子定为父亲报仇。即使不成功而成人，我父子二人不也能留下忠孝之名乎？父亲为何忍辱偷生，做此不义之举？ 亲不能做忠臣，三桂又安能为孝子？自今日起，儿与父断绝关系。父不早吐，流寇即使把父亲置于刀斧油锅之上来要挟三桂，我也绝不回顾。
Breaking all ties with the Xun regime, there was no turning back. In the ensuing battle for survival, Wu Sangui had foreseen an inevitable result.
Li Zicheng's 军队呢有十万人之多，而这个吴三桂的军队呢，也就是在其一半左右能打仗的啊，因为他自己有精兵呢三万。左右，那么再加上原来的山海关的这个守兵啊一万余，再加他招募了一些能打仗的，加在一起也就五六万人，也就是这个样子。那么他这一半的兵来守这个山海关城，那么确实是跟李自成呢的军队是没办法比的。
Wu Sangui knew it was long odds to oppose the 100,000 strong Xun army with only 30,000 men.At that moment, he thought of the Qing regime to the north. But the idea was a deep blow to his pride. When Wu Sangui was stationed in Lingyuan, he passed two archways every day. Each time, he would agonize over the poignant inscriptions.Be loyal and brave with wisdom, and generals with great achievements. These were the praises for his uncles, General Zhu Dashou and General Zhu Dayue, who once guarded the city. But both of them had defected to the Qing regime. More unbearable was his uncle Zhu Dashou's letter persuading Wu Sangui to surrender.Enclosed was an edict from Huan Taiji, which Wu waved aside. No Manchu title could compare to his losses on the surrender, no matter how noble it was. He was famous for loyalty and filial piety in the Ming court. How could he accept the disgrace of surrender?In the past years, Wu Sangui repeatedly refused to surrender to the Qing regime. Now only the Qing forces match the Xun army in strength. He wanted to strike back and break free from this perilous fight. Yet, there was only one way out.On April 12th, Wu asked for reinforcements in a letter to his once mortal enemy. He appealed to the Qing court to help defeat Li Zicheng for the sake of his loyalty to a dead empire.
He is the representative of Ming Chao to issue this letter. He says that Qing Chao is Bei Chao, is Bei Chao and Nan Chao very prominent, not one Chao. This is not mixing. Lie Di is Chao.我将来感谢你的，不是以金银来感谢你，是给你一个地盘，给你土地，来报答你。他非常明确，绝不是降请，是请兵，请求清朝出兵，帮他复仇，恢复明朝统治。
Wu's righteous letter was answered by a disappointing reply.Dorgan vowed to fight against the Xun army, but avoided any mention of military assistance. He also brushed aside the land cession issue and proposed Wu should surrender.
Initially confident of his strategy, Wu was stunned by the results. Under Li Zicheng's command, the Xun army had passed Yongping and fast approaching the Shanhai Pass. A crucial battle was just around the corner. The Shanghai Pass was in great peril, but Dorgan's equivocal attitude made Wu anxious. He sent another letter to Dorgan requesting immediate reinforcements to the Shanghai Pass. Li Zicheng launched a fierce assault on Shanghai Pass on the morning of April 21st. Wu Sangui's 30,000 men had to face 100,000 Xun troops in an ill-matched battle. On the battlefield that day, Wu repeatedly looked beyond the Shanghai Pass, longing for the signs of Qing reinforcements. But it remained quiet as usual well into the afternoon. Greatly outnumbered, the Guanming troops suffered heavy casualties. The Shanghai Pass was at stake. The fierce battle lasted until dusk and came to a halt at nightfall. The much-anticipated Qing army finally arrived. Under Dorgan's orders, they stopped and encamped just outside Shanghai Pass. Wu suddenly realized that Dorgan was holding off for a negotiation.
山海关呢，它是有一座主城和四个浮城，就是东罗、西罗、南翼和北翼，四个浮城有三个浮城都险些被攻破，那么这个是很危险。也就是说，第一天呢，他根本就是感觉到了李自成的攻势非常的猛，他守不住，所以吴三桂呢感到呢，如果说就是在这种情况下，他没有援军，他是守不住这个城。
A battle for survival would take place the next day. Only with help from the Qing army could a victory be possible. However, Dorgan appeared reluctant to lend a hand. Distraught, Wu Sangui immediately sent an envoy to the Qing army camp. It's an unprecedented year in Chinese history. Fight or flee, do or die. The ruler of a falling empire faced his end. How would a grassroots hero steer the fate of a dynasty? Was the formidable general anger for the sake of a beauty? Was Manchu's triumph accidental? Who steered the course of history? Three power groups fought toe-to-toe for domination. What was behind the transition from the Ming to Qing dynasties? 1644. He has strongly rejected Huang Taiji's repeated bids to recruit him over the years. Even as Li Zicheng's army approached, Wu hadn't considered surrendering, but rather requested military aid. Now desperate, Wu started to have second thoughts. The Xun army would cut off all means of retreat after daybreak. The epic change destroyed Wu Sangui's last illusions of loyalty. The cruel reality forced him to abandon his ideals of being a loyal vassal and a filial son. Wu's dreams have been shattered. Uncertain how he would be remembered in history, he let out a long sigh. All he had left were his Guanning troops. Just after daybreak on April 22nd, the east gate of Shanghai Pass opened. The Qing army crossed the Great Wall. But they remained idle. Dorgan ordered Wu Sangui and his Guanning troops to fight as vanguards for the Xun army. Facing an imminent battle and an inviolable order, Wu had no time to hesitate. Helpless, he led the charge against the Xun army. The fierce battle lasted until noon. Without any reinforcement, the Guanning army was trapped. When Wu Sangui nearly gave up, the Qing troops rushed out from the right flank. The sudden offensive of the Eight Banner Cavalry routed the entire Xun army. Li Zicheng fled in a panic with his remnant forces. The tide of battle had turned, but the Guanning troops were decimated. Wu Sangui failed.